Hello and welcome to the Presenter Mastery Podcast. I'm Lucas, CEO of Headgain and amateur speaker.
I don't think you should be calling yourself amateur anymore, man, but we'll have to talk about that. Anyhow, David, expert speaker.
Thank you. And together, we're your weekly guides to mastering presentations.
Yes.
In today's episode, we're going to share with you something very, very special. For the last 6 months, we've been running a webinar called Powerful Presentations. It's an in-depth webinar with you, David, where you talked about the PDC model.
Yes, yes. Going through dopamine, for instance,
yes.
In a bit more depth.
Yeah, storytelling.
Yes. And some 110 steps, which are also core.
Mm.
And we got to say, it's the most liked, it's the best reviewed webinar that we have done to date. But it's only been available via video. And we know a lot of people just listen as well.
Mm.
So therefore,
we're going to push it into the podcast for you to be able to re-listen to it at any time. You can listen to it in double speed if you're into that, out on a run, wherever you are. So we're going to play that for you and just enjoy the ride.
Indeed. Enjoy the ride, use the skills, and pick it up. And remember to practice as soon as you get them.
You're about to embark on a journey in the name of communication where you will learn the basic things that you need to know when it comes to how to deliver, how to create your content, and how to be a good presenter, a good communicator. When David is now going to enter the stage, I hope that you will just go, whoa, and really cheer him on and give him the energy that he deserves. After he has done his session, I'm going to be back here. I'm going to answer. We're going to have a Q&A. So stick around to the end, because after the Q&A, that's where we're going to give you the sweet spot, that little thing that I showed you but I didn't talk too much about. So if you want to be in for a treat, the real treat, you stick around to the end. I think that is enough. Wouldn't you say that, Marcus? That's enough. Let's welcome David to the stage.
Yes.
Let's welcome David J.P. Phillips to this stage, ladies and gentlemen. David J.P. Phillips! Woo!
Wow. Thank you, Alexander, and thank you, Marcus, and thank you, Lucas, and thank you, everybody behind the scenes, and thank you all for being here today. Not just by being here on this keynote, but by actually caring that you want to become a better presenter, better communicator, because that will impact not only yourself, but everyone around you. I'm going to jump straight into the skills now, the knowledge, the stuff I want to give you. I've spent 20 years in the profession of communication skills and public speaking. I've been traveling the world. I've been coaching and still coaching the best. I want to boil down 5 things that I want to give you today, which, if you have not been using them before, will easily, from an objective point of view, will easily get other people to perceive your presentations as double or triple as powerful as they were before. Just imagine that. What an investment, just 1 hour, which will give you skills and tools, which will have such an amazing impact if you have not been using them before. And I'm going to ask Alexander to bring in my flip chart.
Flip chart time.
Yes. And just to make this easy for you, or easier for you, I want you to just imagine, look around you and ask yourself, the most influential and successful people around you. Who are they? What is one common denominator among these people? They are good at communication skills. They are good at making their voice heard. When they go to an interview, people listen to them. When they have a product or a service, people enjoy it, they like it, they listen to it. That is so fascinating that the 1% most successful people around, either success from just being happy or success from earning a lot of money or in career, are good communicators. They are good at making their voice heard. So to break this down, I look at it in regards as a triad. And each of these steps are equally important for any communicator and presenter. The first one is the presenter itself, i.e. your mental state, your internal communication, what you say to yourself before going into a meeting, after a meeting. Like if you're going to go to an important negotiation or you're going to go to a meeting which is, it's an important that the outcome of it works really well. If you keep telling yourself in here, oh, imagine if they ask this. Imagine if this happens. Oh my God, I can't do this. I'm not good enough. I'm not good. These are better than I am. If you keep on insisting, saying those things to yourself before going wherever, to a meeting, to a date, to a presentation, doesn't matter. That will influence your external communication to such a massive, massive degree. So mental state, mindset, that is one part of the triad, which I would recommend you to become fluent in, i.e. your internal communication. Secondly, I'll actually go here first. Content. How do you structure a presentation? How do you start? How do you end? How do you grab? How do you hold attention? How do you create memories? How do you move people from A to B? How do you get people to believe in your idea? Storytelling. How to deliver great PowerPoints. Just as Alexander said, I have two of the biggest TED Talks in the world with millions and millions of views. If you haven't looked at them, it's 18 minutes each. They are brilliant as they are. Have a look at that to learn more about content as well. And then we have delivery skills. That is your ability to use your body, to use your hands, to use your facial expressions, to use your voice in order to become or be the best version you can be. So let's have a look at that. I'm going to show you, or Marcus will be showing you a big screen of my latest study. I started looking, or rather, about 10, 15 years into my profession, I started seeing mathematical patterns in human behavior and human communication styles. It's quite weird, but when you do something for so long, that kind of happens to you. So if I look at you now, and I look at your behaviors, I can see that some of you are nodding when I speak. So then I ask myself, as a coach, does that matter? Like if you're in a communication situation and somebody nods, does that matter? I can see some of you are tilting your head slightly to the left. Does that matter? It matters to a massive degree. So what I did then as a coach, I took the head tilt, I took the head nod, and then I recommended my clients who weren't using these skills to start using them. And they came back to me within a week and they said, that's just baffling, David. That is baffling. Because suddenly people spoke more to me, they opened up more to me, they were more personal to me than they'd been before. I had so many managers who've increased their grades as managers and had promotions just by simple skills like this, because suddenly they were perceived as they cared. They cared before, but they weren't perceived as they were caring. I had one manager who constantly just did this whenever people spoke to him. Nothing else. Just looked at them like this. That's scary. It doesn't matter if you care or not. You're not showing that you care. So in this case, I told him, tilt your head and nod affirmatively when they speak. And boom, within a moment, they started speaking more to him and his grades practically doubled as a manager. So I asked myself, are there more skills like this? That's only two of them. And I can see some of you using them. Some of you are not using them. So I spent 7 years studying 5,000 public speakers in order to identify as many as I could. I couldn't find any more. And I came to 110 skills, and they look like this. So if Marcus, if you can show this in full screen. So this is the level of nerdiness in me and in my team. 110 skills. 110 skills that all of you can use all of you, in order to become a greater presenter, greater partner, greater boss, greater salesperson. Doesn't matter. Better on YouTube, better on social media, better on Instagram. Doesn't matter. So have a look at them once more and guess. How many of these do you think that the average presenter uses? Average presenter employed in the company. How many? Two from Laurent. Yeah, that's a good guess, Laurent. It's a bit low. The rest of you, just type in the chat. How many of these skills do you think they use? Okay, I've got to make something clear. When you're dead, you have 7 skills. Okay? So whoever you are working in the companies with 2, 5, 6 skills, I don't want to go there. The best people in your company, the best people around you, the 1%, how many of these skills do they use? How many skills do the most successful people use? And the answer is around 55. So you don't have to hit the roof with 110. 55 the best communicators and presenters in companies around. Best keynote speakers, which is my profession, they can usually land about 80 to 85 skills. They're usually the most skilled presenters out there. So I want to start off by giving you one skill, one more skill. I've already given you 2 skills. Tilt your head, nod your head affirmatively when somebody speaks to you in order to show that you actually care. A, you have to care to begin with. This won't allow you to start caring. So that has to be your personality trait to start with. I'm going to give you one more. I'm going to give you a couple of skills on that, and I'm going to give you one skill on that. But we're going to start off with the most important skill in regards to delivery skills. So we'll show this one again, Marcus. I'm going to have a look at skill 25. Can you see what that reads? Skill 25 is what I would define as the most important skill of these. As Alexander said, this is a resource package, so you can get to, you can acquire this after the presentation. But 25 is filler sounds. So filler sounds are the small sheep sounds that you tend to make now and then. Not all of you, but I'd say approximately 80% of you do sheep sounds. They sound like this. Or a version of any of those. What's interesting with filler sounds is if I were to follow you for a week, I would find that you use the greatest concentration of filler sounds, listen very carefully, when you are nervous, anxious, scared, when you've lost train of thought, when you don't know what to say, when you're unprepared, or when you're lying, or when you're thinking. So if I'd follow you around, I'd find a pattern in that. There's 8 reasons we use filler sounds practically. The problem with that is that if you use filler sounds, you leave it up to the other person to try to figure out why you are using them. So you leave it up to the other person. If you're in an interview situation, you leave it up to the interviewer to try to figure out, are you using a filler sound now to think? Or are you lying to me? Or are you anxious? Or are you just thinking? And you don't want to leave such important margins to the other side. What's also interesting, if I were to follow you for 1 week, I would find that the least concentration of filler sounds would be coming out of you when you are confident, when you are sure of yourself, when you know what you're going to say, when you have a clear train of thought in your head. So the power of this, and this is so cool, that if you remove your filler sounds and replace it with pauses, you will instantaneously, and this is so powerful, you will instantaneously be perceived as more confident, irrespective of what you talk about. Talk about power skill. One skill makes you seem more confident, and oddly enough, due to something called the somatic feedback loop, you will also feel more confident when you pause instead of using sheep sounds. So to give you an idea what this sounds like, I'm going to give you a classical rhetorical proverb, right? It's a Greek one. It's old. It's about what drives our decisions. I'm going to give you 3 versions of it. The first one, no pauses. The second one has pauses. And the third one has filler sounds. Listen to the three examples. Did you know that every single decision you've ever taken in your entire life and you will take for the rest of your life is based on one thing and one thing only, and that is an emotion? If you give that emotion to the people listening, they will take the decisions you want them to take. And my coach comes in, slaps me over the head and says, "Hey, David, your volume is great, pace is a bit too fast, but your pauses, they suck." Fair enough. He whispers something in my ear and I go, "Okay, cool. Can I go again?" And he goes, okay. "Oh, man, better pauses this time." Cool. So same proverb. Did you know that every single decision you've ever taken in your entire life and you will take for the rest of your life is based on one thing and one thing only? And that is an emotion. If you give that emotion to the people listening to you, they will have a greater chance of taking the decisions you want them to take. Is there a difference? Suddenly, the word an emotion became very clear, but before it wasn't. But what is scary is that based on my experience, 80% of the average population uses filler sounds, which would allow it to sound like this. Did you know that every single decision you've ever taken in your entire life and you will take for the rest of your life is based on one thing and one thing only? And that is an emotion. If you give that emotion to the people who are listening, they will take the decisions you want them to take. One skill builds confidence and removes uncertainty. So I've given you three skills on delivery. I know they will have a big impact on you when you apply them and use them in your life. We're going to move over to content. I'm going to just move this back a step. And I'm going to take you here. All right. So I'd like to introduce you to the first content subject, which is storytelling. The reason I want to introduce you to that is that I'm not kidding you. I am not kidding. This is entirely honest. I have never, ever come across a tool, a technique within communication skills and public speaking, which is more powerful than storytelling, even proven from a scientific point of view. Stories, we remember them 20 times better than facts. 20 times. That is an insane number. So if you ever find it important for someone to remember what you're talking about, introduce it as a story. So what I'm about to show you now, I could just present as facts, but I'll present it as the story as it was. So I'll take you back to 2009. A man by the name Rob Walker was just baffled by how somebody paid $1.5 million for the red leather jacket that Michael Jackson was wearing in the music video Thriller. Well, the same jacket, maybe that would cost $20 in a thrift shop. Why would somebody pay $1.5 million just because Michael Jackson wore it? Michael Jackson is just a story, nothing else. So he asked himself, wonder if the same thing happens if we apply stories to just random objects. So he walks over to eBay, logs into his computer, buys 200 random objects, you know, truly random, strange things, normal things. He gets them. He pays about $1 each. He then calls an author up and he says, "Hey, I've got this interesting study coming up. I'm going to call it the Significant Object Study. I want to prove that storytellings are beyond powerful. Could you write me a story to one of the objects?" And the author was intrigued and said, "Absolutely." He wrote a story to this horse's head. And the horse's head story was about a father's daughter lived in Paris during the 50s, the story said that this was stuck in the Louvre overnight. It's been stuck in a drunken cell. All right, so that's the story. Nothing special. He called up another 199 authors. At the end of the day, he had 200 stories and 200 objects, and so it was time to publish them on eBay again. Logs in, publishes them. And the question then is, would there be a difference? Would there be a difference? Small, big, huge, massive. This horse's head was purchased for 99 cents and sold for $62.95. And if you quicken maths, you know that that is a slight value increase of 6,258%. What happened to the 200 objects? Well, in total, they were purchased for $129 and sold for $8,000. Based on a story, nothing else. The image was the same. Whatever specifications were identical. The only difference was a story. When we become emotionally involved, our perception of whatever we're looking at increases. This is forgery, because the stories were fake, so they had to give the money back. The study was, however, replicated 4 times with equal results. What's interesting, though, is that the stories that you have about yourself, about your products, about your services, are all true. But by just simply not telling them, you're holding back on that potential value increase. So tell more stories on LinkedIn. Tell more stories on Instagram. Tell more stories on TikTok. Tell more stories in your meetings, in your presentations. Start with a story. End with a story. Why? Because stories is how we perceive the world as human beings. You don't think in tables. You don't think in charts. You don't think in numbers. You don't think in percentages. You think in stories. You think in narratives. You simulate the future. You replay the past. And I just want to stop there. Change camera angle. What did I just say? You replay the past, you simulate the future to understand your presence or present. Look at that. That is the presenter. So if you're going to a meeting and it's your 7th and the 8th before that had failed, and you keep thinking about those old meetings, oh, it failed, it failed, it failed, it failed, you as a presenter will be impacting your internal communication to such a degree that it will impact your external communication. Here's a fun fact. You, whether you're a man or a woman, have a hormone called testosterone. It has been shown in studies that if you increase your testosterone levels before an interview, you have a bigger chance of getting the job. It has also been proven that if you increase your testosterone levels before a negotiation, you get a better deal when leaving. That is the presenter. How to know how to increase your testosterone levels, because anyone can do that before a meeting or a presentation. So the stories you tell yourself, well, to be absolutely frank with you, about 7 years ago, I realized that I was depressed, and I had been depressed for the majority of my adult life, approximately 17 years. I had a successful career, I was still functioning, but I didn't want to live. I hacked my depression, and what I realized was that my internal communication was so bad. I was constantly repeating the worst versions of the stories in my head over and over and over and over and over and over again, and had been doing for so many years that it led me to my depression. I hacked my depression. These last 6-7 years have been the best in my life. And that was what allowed me to find that final skill, how to truly be able to communicate with yourself, to increase your testosterone levels when you want to, the dopamine levels when you want to, oxytocin levels when you want to, and so on. So my advice to you in this case is simply this: tell your stories, okay? I just want to inspire you that it's that powerful. The James Bond movies, we go to them. It's almost more entertaining looking at the people coming out of the movie than looking at the movie itself, because people walk differently when they've gone to similar James Bond movies. They walk like in a cocky way when they leave the cinema. You can easily spot them, that one, and that one. Some people, I think you've felt this as well. You've watched a movie and it has changed your emotional state, impacting how you walk, how you think. For instance, did you know that if you look at a movie and the character in the movie wins, your testosterone levels increases? I.e., we relate so much to characters in movies, in TV shows, and in theater plays that it impacts our emotional state in regards to testosterone if the main character wins or succeeds. A James Bond watch, the Omega watch. How many percent more value increase does he bring to that? Just borrowing the store of James Bond increases the value of Omega by thousands, ten thousands of percent. God damn, it's something that tells time. But still, some people are willing to pay way, way, way beyond its actual value. Stories are incredible. I want to give you one example of stories. Pepsi versus Coca-Cola. I don't know which one is your favorite, but here's an interesting fact. When they do blind tests, Pepsi wins. So in this study, they looked at how the brain reacted. And when they drank Pepsi, a particular part of the brain lit up, which relates to taste. So it tastes clinically better, right? But when people get the option to see, then they prefer Coke or Coca-Cola. Why? Well, what they saw then was that the part of the brain who commands visual experiences and stories lit up. In this study, it showed that the story of Coca-Cola impacted our perception of taste even more than the taste itself, due to all the commercials, for instance, we've seen about Coca-Cola. This is obviously individual, but just showing how powerful stories can be. The next thing I want to give you on content is dopamine. And I'd say that this is the most important neurochemical of all neurochemicals. I'd actually venture to say that based on 20 years in my life, doing this subject, I'd say dopamine is the most important thing to get right in any presentation. So dopamine, just to give you a perspective, is that feeling of, oh, it's soon Friday, I can't wait, it's soon Friday, I can't wait. Or your friends are coming and you go like, oh, I can't wait for them to come. Or you've bought this new thing. You bought a new mobile phone, or you bought a new book, the next book in a series, or, oh my God, the next chapter of this TV show or the next season is coming out on Sunday. Every single time you experience the sensation of desire, it's dopamine. I want you to write this down. Dopamine equals... the anticipation of reward. So at the very end of this session today, after the Q&A, I'm going to give you the best tool I have created. But I'll place that there just for the effect of the anticipation of reward. Just as an example. So how can you create dopamine in the people that you're talking to? Well, whenever you create the sensation of something good coming up, that will be dopamine. Simon Sinek, absolute legend. I hope that you've heard of him. If not, have a look at his TED talk on why. He talks about the why and why that is powerful. You see, when people, and this is where dopamine comes in, when people understand why something is relevant, why something is interesting, why it can help them in their life, why they can become richer, why they can become more famous, why they can become more liked, why they can get more dates or jobs or whatever, whenever they understand that there's a win in it, dopamine is created. That is the very foundation of evolution, the desire to grow. So whatever presentation you are doing, in the beginning of your presentation, please define and tell your audience why they should listen. Why is this interesting? Why is this relevant? Why? And the better you make that why, the more you will see people going like this. From to boom. Oh yeah, yeah, oh yeah. Oh yeah, oh yeah. That entire transition from going, to almost being sleepy to being, oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. That is an entire dopamine process. And you can literally see it come alive in your audience. But then the question is it enough with one why? Can you just do one in the beginning of a presentation and then just leave it for 40 minutes? No. I'd say you need a good why at least every 2 minutes. Every time you go into a new subject, why? Every time you go into a new slide, why? If you can, like, just in small doses describe why is this important? Why is this technique important? Why is this skill important? Every single time you do that, you inject a little bit of dopamine. And that means that you get their focus, you increase their motivation, their creativity we know goes up, and they remember what you're saying more clearly. I just want to ask you this. In your next meeting or presentation, would you like the opposite of this? Would you like your audience to be unfocused, unmotivated, uncreative, and they cannot remember what you're saying? Anyone, hands up. Because if that's not what you want, you have no other option. It doesn't matter how well you prepare your structure, your beginning, your ending, your stories. It doesn't matter if you have not pre-planned how dopamine will be injected throughout your presentation. You will lose your audience now and then over and over again. So I'm going to give you an example on this. I've given you one tool, the why. I'm going to give you one more, which is storytelling. I'm going to tell you two stories. Well, it's actually the same story. But the first version, which is about 25 seconds long, has no dopamine. The second version has dopamine, right? So I'm going to tell you the same story, but I'm going to add dopamine in the second version. So the question is, how do I do that? Because if you can see how I can do it, you can do it too in any presentation or meeting or story. So first version goes like this. The man woke up in the morning. He looked to his right. He saw the bed was empty. He got on his feet, put on his slippers, walked to the door, which was open. He saw the tracks coming out of the bathroom. He walked down the corridor. He came to the balcony. He walked close to the railing and he looked over the railing into the pool. The end. Now that is per definition a story because it's an event which is being retold. Any event that is retold is a story. But it lacks dopamine. So it's not very interesting. Let's add dopamine and now see the difference. Are you ready? Okay, let's have some head nods. Remember that skill, affirmative listening. Well done, well done. We're getting there, we're getting there. Okay, here's version number two. The man woke up in the morning. It was all too silent. It shouldn't have been. He looked to his right and he saw the bed was empty and he thought to himself, no, where is my son? He put on his slippers. He ran to the door. It was open. He knew he'd locked it. He feared the worst. He came out into the hallway. He saw the wet tracks coming out of the bathroom towards the pool area. His hair stood up over his entire body. He screamed internally. He said, no! I told him not to. He ran down that corridor as fast as you humanly can. He came to the balcony. He walked to the railing. And this is a true story. This happened about 7 years ago to one of my friends. He leaned over. He practically threw up. He looked into the pool and what he saw and the end. Now, the chances of you wanting to know how that ended is now bigger than the first version, right? Right, yes. Why? Why do you care more about the second version than the first version? It's just same story, equal, same process. So give me some ideas. Different tones, more accent, more expression, harmonious, yes. And entered feelings, people can relate. Okay, cool, yes, good ideas. Keep on going, keep on guessing. Emotions, feelings, suspension, yes. Personal, good. Feelings, yes. All of these are great. And you're heading in the right direction, but none of you have answered the right question yet. What did I do? What was the thing? I added dopamine, but how? Some people are writing, build anticipation, anticipation. Yes, but how was that done? Expectation. All right, here we go. Ask questions. Usman, you're getting close there. All right, this is the answer. Please write this down. Unanswered questions. That's it. If I can place questions in a story which may remain unanswered and you want an answer to them, dopamine is created. And in this story, I created 10 of them. Why was the bed empty and he was worried about it? Why did his heart start beating fast? Why was he worried about his son? Why did he run to the door? Why did he run down the corridor? Why did his hair stand up over his entire body? Why did he almost throw up? Why did I mention it was a real story? All of this are unanswered questions. And it's the reason you watch any TV show. You, like, literally like, or Lord of the Rings, right? Lord of the Rings. It's one ring which needs to go from here into a volcano. It takes 3 movies. The unanswered question is, how do they get the ring from there into the volcano? And we just keep on buying it. We just keep going to movie after movie, episode after episode after episode, because we want to know what the answer to the question is. So when you build your presentations, you cannot just throw up a slide and say, this is it, and then go through it. Because there are no unanswered questions left. There is no anticipation. There is nothing new to come. They've already seen the entire slide. So to give you an example of this. This is just like a simple chart, 0 to 100. We're going to check which of these 3 car models is the fastest. We have the Porsche 911 Turbo S. It's a beautiful Porsche, very fast. Tesla Plaid from Elon Musk and the supercar. The question then is, which of these is the fastest, right? So help me out. The Porsche 911 Turbo S, just say it in your head. Do you think it's fast? How fast is it? 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds? And it is 3.2 seconds. So that is crazy fast. For anyone that's gone in that, you get your wits scared out of you because the engine is so loud. Compare that to a Tesla Plaid, which is very silent. Can an electrical car be faster? Let me see it. Can you nod if you believe it's faster? Okay, seems like a lot of you believe so, some do not. The answer to this is whoop-boom, 2 seconds. That is whiplash fast. That is roller coaster fast. And then we have supercars, non-street legal, and they are faster. What's interesting with this is that the data is not correct. You may not even care about cars, but I still got you hooked, didn't I? I still had you going, I think it's faster, it could be faster. Yes, I do believe. What's interesting with this is it's unanswered questions. So whenever you create a presentation with charts and you are not animating them, you are simply pouring down dopamine into a black endless well for it to disappear. Animate your charts, animate your most important data, animate your most important bits in a table. And the same thing with a presentation or a story. Don't just give it all away. Build, build, give a bit. Build, build, build. Push anticipation. Give a bit. That's the nature of human focus, comes from the anticipation of reward of unanswered questions. I'm going to give you one more element now in content, and that is another neurosubstance called oxytocin. Full screen on that, Marcus. So oxytocin is a neuropeptide in all of you. It is, listen very carefully, it is what allows you to love. It is what allows you to like. It is what allows you to connect with other human beings. It is the reason people trust you. It is the reason you get new friends. It is also the reason why you break up with friends and partners. Oxytocin is what connects human beings together. So I'll give you an example. You're at a dinner, you're talking about weather, wind, nothing special, blah, blah, blah. Suddenly, one of you shares something with a little bit of vulnerability, something personal that has happened to you. Suddenly, the other person will do something similar. And within just 5 minutes, you will have connected more than you did hours before that. Right? You've been there, haven't you? You know how to create these connections by opening up a little bit about yourself. But some managers, in their communication style, they choose to hold back. They don't want to seem vulnerable. They don't want to seem human. They want to seem superior. But the problem with that is that you don't allow yourself to connect with other human beings, to create trust in that case. So if you want to create a bond with you and the audience, if you want to create a bond in a meeting, in an interview, it doesn't matter. Oxytocin is your friend. And write that down, to be personal and to have the guts to be a little bit more vulnerable. Doesn't matter if it's on social media or in real life. It will allow you to connect with other people. So I've taken you through now 3 skills on delivery. We've done 3 different content areas on content. I'm going to give you, and we've also done one on the presenter as well. Communicate with yourself is an important skill. I want to show you the most asked question since I did my TED talk on the magical science of storytelling. So that has close to 5 million views now. I've had this question 1,000 times and it goes like this. But David, how on earth do I get stories into my meetings? How do I add a story into a meeting? How do I add a story in a conversation? How? I can't just go, I've got a story. Nah, you can't. That's weird. So the question is, what are the methods to get stories into meetings? So I spent a long time analyzing this, and I found that there are 5 primary ways that good storytellers are able to inject stories into any meeting and presentation and conversation. I call it the A, B, C, D, O's of business storytelling. 5 ways to inject stories into any meeting that you have or presentation that you have. We don't have time to go through all 5. I'll just quickly go through what they mean. A stands for answers, B bouncers, C counters, D duos, and O objects. We'll cover A though, because I'd find that to be probably the most easy one for you to use. So A is answers. So become aware of the following, that good storytellers and anyone that is good at moving other people are very, very skilled at answering questions with stories. Right? I'll say that again. They are very good at answering questions with stories. So you ask me a question, and instead of just answering yes or no or with data or with any verbal combination, I instead choose to tell a 20-second story about an experience I had last week which responds to the question. Or a 10-second story, or a 40 or a 50-second story. Good, influential people, that 1%, are incredibly good at answering questions with stories. So what I want to say with this is this. Number one, start listening for that. Start listening how people around you do it, right? And you'll notice that some are very good at it. And they are the people who can make an entire room just go silent when they come into the room. Because not because they have so much respect, but that as well, but also because people are automatically drawn to them as magnets, as somebody they want to be around. Isn't that pretty cool when it comes to communication skills? People who are really good at communication skills, people want to be around them. I get this question so many times on TikTok and Instagram, literally 100 questions every month, which sound like this. How can I get more friends? How can I become more popular? And then I say, learn to listen and to care and people will automatically want to be your friend. Because at the end of the day, when they look at longitude studies over happiness, like the longest study on happiness was 50 years long, they came down to that it wasn't money, it wasn't career, it wasn't status, but it was social situations, social network around you that created the ultimate version of happiness for human mankind. And the same thing goes in business. Communication skills is not just about talking, it is equally much about listening and responding correctly to that. So, if I haven't been outstandingly clear that storytelling is powerful, I just want to show you this. It is believed that we started using stories about 250,000 years ago. Some believe it's way longer than that. We started using stories to transfer communication skills, or transfer knowledge from generation to generation. 27,000 years ago, we started drawing things on cave paintings in order to transfer knowledge from generation to generation. 3,500 years ago, the first inscriptions are found with letters transferring knowledge from generation to generation. 28 years ago, PowerPoint was founded. Still, some people believe that PowerPoint is something that they should use all the time in their presentations. No. And if I'm not clear enough, this is how long we've been using storytelling as the primary way of transferring knowledge from generation to generation. This is how long we've been using PowerPoint. The biggest mistake you can do when presenting is believing that your presentation is a PowerPoint. It's not. It's a visual tool which can enhance what you're saying. A good presentation is a combination of all. Start with a story, use a flip chart, use a bit of PowerPoint, ask a question, get an interaction in the chat, It's a combination of variations that create the power of true presentations. Hey, this is, I'd say, arguably, this is the most influential skill in your entire life. It'll influence anything you do in your career, in your profession, and privately. So the question now is, how do you go ahead with this? You've received some amazing tools here. So you, in basis, you have three options. Option number one is that you go, nah, I'll find another way to propel myself in my career. I'll find another way to become better. I don't want to learn communication skills. I don't want to become good at that. Option number two is that you do what I did. You invest your life in it. I've spent 20 years doing this, and you do the same thing. Read books, analyze people, record yourself on video. That's a great one. Look at yourself in a mirror. That's a great one. Prepare, rehearse, look at what you've done, look at the feedback, change, repeat, combine models until you find your thing. Or you do what I think is the most efficient way. You learn from what I just taught you. If you thought this was valuable, I think you did. I'd like to just offer you an insight into my Present Mastery training program and what that is, and if it suits you, because it doesn't suit everyone, and everyone isn't allowed to come into it. It's an application. But if you get into it, it is life-changing and career-changing. So what is Present Mastery? A, it gives you the framework on how to build any presentation. It gives you the framework on how to grab and hold attention for an hours on end, if you wish. It gives you the skills that you need to hold people's attention in video meetings and how to create your video meeting. Not only that, but what I love with it is that it'll take you through the entire storytelling program. And just that is worth an arm and a leg. It is so powerful to be able to increase the value of what you're saying by thousands of percent and give it the right value it deserves. These are all videos. So the video content of the course is, listen to this, 100 videos and 16 hours of learning. And what I love about it is this. It is the recipe to get millions of views. More or less. Because people ask me, and have asked me for a long time, how could you have had now a total of 11 million views on your TED Talks. How? How can you have 70 million views on TikTok? How? What is the recipe for that? And that recipe is in the training. It is way longer than I can take you through in this point of time. That's the video section. And that, well, if you don't have time to go through 100 videos, I can just say this. Just the level one, this is a promise, just level one out of three, just level one. If you learn that, you'll become one of the 1% presenters in your company. Bar none. Like, that's the promise. That is how powerful the skills are. The second part of this, and this is where it gets exciting, that is that you get to do this with me and my team every week. Imagine what would happen to your life if you could do that. Be in a live workshop like this, because then it's not a keynote. I've just been speaking to you mostly now. But in the weekly sessions that we do live like this over Zoom, we practice with you. So you get an exercise, you go out, you do with the group, you come back, you get more skills, you go out with the group, you come back, you get feedback, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, until you become really good at dopamine, until you become really good at storytelling, until you become really good at filler sounds. Like, three sessions ago, we spent 30 minutes removing people's filler sounds. And it just, that just single thing makes such a big impact. So you have one live session like this every week for an entire year, if you wish. That is life and career changing. The third, and I love this. As I said, what did I say? Do you remember? The longest longitude study done on happiness came down to that it's not about money, it's not about career, it's not about status, it is about people that you have around you. So the third bit in this program is the forum, where people are engaged, they help each other. You can ask any question you have. You can go like, I have a presentation next week, I've got a problem with my attention grabber, what should I think about? I have a problem with my why, and I can't create enough dopamine after 20 minutes, what should I do? I have coaches, a large number of them, who will be curating the forum. So the people in it and the coaches will help you out with any questions you have on any presentation for an entire year. Wow, that is big. And this last bit is mind-blowingly powerful. You cannot find it anywhere on this planet. What is it? It's the 110 steps. Do you remember them? 25 was filler sounds. Do you remember the 110 steps? Not affirmatively, if you do. Yeah, okay, cool. We've learned that skill. Great, it's okay. What my coaches will do is you send a video in. My coaches will then spend about 1 hour analyzing every single skill that you do. And I just love this. And pinpoint the 5 most important skills for you to work on, not general. Imagine this being like somebody likes playing golf and they have this swing and they go to a training and there's 10 people there and they get generic advice, so maybe they grow a little bit. But do you know what happens if that coach goes up to that person and says, just move your right hand up 1 centimeter, angle the left one just slightly, and boom, the person is doing a 10% better drive. They would never have received that training in general, or that advice in general, but only in coaching. So when you have one coach who looks at your entire presentation and drills down to which of the 110 skills is the most important for you to work on, you get something called exponential growth. You will grow more from that analysis than generic training anywhere around, just bar none. My ambition is always for this to be the best training in the world for public speaking. And if you find one out there which is better than this training, come to me personally and I want to talk to you, because I want to learn from that. Because the aim of it is to create the best training in the world for public speaking and presentation skills. Bar none. That's the aim. So you have all of this. And of course, at the end, when you've done all this, you get a certification that you are a certified communicator and public speaker and presenter. And you can use that in your career. I saw now that it is one of the 3 top skills that any recruiter is looking for in people when they recruit. As a public speaker, I will tell you how much I earn when I'm out doing my keynotes. I will tell you how I do that. I will tell you how I built my career so that you can do the same thing. I'll tell you how to get into the movement and into the realm of keynote speakers, which is what I did. My first keynotes, I was able to charge 400 euros for. So that's about $400. And these days, when I go to certain companies in the US, I can charge up to $50,000. The profession as a keynote speaker is one of the best paid professions on the planet, at least top 20, top 25. And you don't need to go through an academic training for 6, 7, or 8 years to accomplish that. 1 year of learning this will accomplish the same thing. So that is the Presenter Mastery Training Program. It is extensive and it's just amazing. Now, the thing is this, all of you are not allowed to come into it. What do I mean with that? Well, it's super important for us that I'm going to give you a link very soon in the chat where you can book a call with one of my coaches. It's not going to be a selling call. It's not going to be a hard sell at all. It is just a call with a coach of mine to listen to who you are, what you need, what you want, and if the program is a good match for you. If you both agree, that's great. So what I'm asking for the people who come into the program is this. You have to be serious. You can't dabble around. We don't want you. We want people who go into the program and they go like, okay, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna invest in myself. I'm gonna become better at communication skills and public speaking because I get it. I get it. This is important, right? So that's one of the two important things that come out of this. Number two is that when you come into the program, it's important that you also have an open heart for other human beings, that you want to help others, and that you're just not there for your egoistical self. Because a big part of this is, well, I think the beauty of this is that the people in this program, if you get to know them, when you get to know them, you will create an entirely new network of like-minded, beautiful, ambitious, energetic, helpful people. Like the people in the Presenter Mastery program are some of the most beautiful people I've met. So if you are serious and if you are open to helping out, yes, then click this link. So we're going to open that up. This link will take you to an option to book that call. All of you can book it as long as those two. You're serious, you want to invest in yourself, and you're open to assisting and helping others in the process of growing. I think that's the most important thing on this planet Earth. If we're not open to helping others, how can we make a better world together? So go in there. The spots are limited, of course. I currently have five coaches. So there are limited spots. And if I look at the combined feed that we have from various channels at the moment, we're looking at about 2,000 people looking at this stream at the moment. All of you will definitely not be able to book a call. But go in there so that you can apply for the Presenter Mastery Training Program. It's important that you can apply for the Presenter Mastery Training Program. Talk to that coach. And I love this. These calls have a 4.9 evaluation out of 5. Because the coach will also give you some free advice when you're on the call. Maybe on nervousness, maybe on storytelling, maybe on your career or something like that. But they've all been trained according to my program, so they are highly, highly professional in the sense of public speaking and communication skills. All right, so what we are going to do now is we are going to dive into the Q&A. So we're going to do a Q&A, answer all questions as we can for about 10 minutes. So any questions that you have, prepare them. We're going to just rearrange this area a bit. So we're just going to take a pause for 2 minutes to rearrange it. I'm going to bring in Stipe, who's one of the coaches who sit on the calls. so that you can ask him any and all questions before you jump on the call, like, shall I prepare something? What shall I think about? And then Alexander, my beautiful friend in the beginning, the best coach I know, he's also going to come in here and answer all and any questions. It's super valuable with a Q&A because that's when you get your voice heard and all the beautiful questions you've been answering in the chat will, well, they'll try to answer as many as possible. When they are done, the smoke machine will go on again. But when the smoke has disappeared, I'll come back and I'll give you that final last tool, which is, I believe, the best thing I have created and something that will have a true impact. So get on that link, book your free coaching call. There are no expectations besides you wanting to invest in yourself and a desire to help others. Listen into the program and see if it's for you. And 2 minutes and I will be back, or they will be back and then I will be back. Okay, it's been lovely seeing you. I hope that these tips have been valuable for you, even if you can't make it to the coaching call. I know they're valuable based on my experience. They will have a tremendous effect on your presentations if you have not used them before. All right, so see you in a moment.
Wow, that was nice, wasn't it? I enjoyed it. Did you enjoy it?
I loved every second about it.
Did you guys enjoy it? Yeah, it was a good session. That's almost amazing. All right, so let's jump in and dig into the questions. So here's the thing. This is Stipe. This is Stipe. This is our coach. This is also the gentleman who is in charge of who is allowed into the program and is not, right?
I'm the gatekeeper.
Yeah, he's the gatekeeper. So well, if you have any questions regarding the program, please feel free to ask them and Stipe will be happy to answer them. And if you have any questions regarding public speaking, I will be happy to assist you in that as well. So we are looking at the questions that are coming in. Let's go with that one. Hey, first of all, David was talking about the coaching calls. How often are they and when are they?
They're going to be every week. So we're going to do them for a year. So we're going to have 52 opportunities to join. And we're going to alternate between morning and an evening time. This is to accommodate all the time zones, all the working schedules for those who work in the morning, in the evening. And the schedule is very clear in the community, so you'll be able to see what's coming up. It was never designed for you to participate in all 52, I would say. You're given 52 opportunities where you can. And whatever you miss, you can go and watch the recording.
Yeah, right? Exactly. That was the follow. Like, what happens if you miss one?
All of them recorded. Just go press play on a weekend in a car, in a meeting, not while driving, though. All right? Yeah. Pause, park, pull up the vehicle, then you can watch the recording.
That's nice. All right, we have a question here from Adam. Any tips when you don't have control of the content on the PowerPoint? I believe this is a question that I will give you some addressation to, or I don't even know if that's a word, but okay. So when you don't have control about the PowerPoint, what do you do? I guess you are saying that you don't have control of what it looks like and the way that it's created or it's structured. My advice to this, stop relying yourself to the PowerPoint. That would be my honest and just straight up opinion. What we have as a it's a misful truth that we are working in is that it's always the PowerPoint that runs the presentation. That is the first and single biggest mistake that we do. You are the presentation. You've always been and you always will be. What we do when we don't have control, we need to start gaining the control by the realization going, okay, I am the presentation. The PowerPoint that I'm going to show or I'm going to view or have shown is just a graphical enhancing tool. So how do you then take the control of that is to start just, number one, get to not be relying on it so much. Start learning whatever it is. So if you get a corporate presentation down to you and it's like, hey, you have to present this, well, focus then on doing this. Maybe just start talking, creating the stories that reflects whatever the PowerPoint is telling. And then on some occasions, you just show them the PowerPoint, just as a graphically enhancing whatever you just told them. But remember this, guys, the biggest fear that, or the biggest mistake that you can do is to just have a PowerPoint on all the time and just go, okay, so today I'm gonna talk about, and then you look over and you start chatting and then you take the next slide and the next slide and the next slide. I know this sounds like you have to spend hours and hours and hours to learn whatever PowerPoint it is, but there are so many great tools in that, just using the presenter's view as an example, where you will be able to put down your notes in the key section down there where it takes notes section, and then you will be able to see whatever it is that you need to talk about for the slide that's behind you. Again, not being controlled by the PowerPoint, but just having it as a graphical enhancing tool. So Adam, I hope that could answer your question. I could go on and rant on for how to use PowerPoint for hours and hours. Like I told in the beginning, this is how I got hooked with coming into and working with together with David for the last, it was 15 years ago when I met him the first time.
That's crazy.
Yeah, and now I've been working for him for the last 10 years.
You haven't aged.
I haven't aged.
Which is ridiculous.
Thank you for that. Let's see what other questions we got. We have any, oh, let's see, what can we have here? How much time, oh, this is a good one for you, Stipe. How much time should I invest in the program?
Well, if you're David J.P. Phillips, it's about 20 years plus. But this is the best part. I would say progressively over time is the key to mastering any skill, right? Guitar playing. You don't expect to be a guitar player within 2 days. Slow and steady is how we go. This is why the program is 12 months long, right? This is why we don't think that the workshops that are 2 days are going to create as much of an impact. Spend 1 hour a week for the content. And practice is everywhere around you, grocery store, restaurant, your kids, your colleagues, all right? That is where you make it on autopilot. So I would say join every second coaching call and maybe an hour or two for the content a week, slow and steady, progressively over time is gonna make a difference after a couple of months.
Yeah.
So not too much. We also knew when we were building this, we're going to be dealing with some busy people, so we made sure to optimize it for any schedule, regardless how busy you are, to make sure that it's not too overwhelming, right?
Yep, no, that's true. We have another question. I believe that this one be, oh, this is an area where I really love going into the deep end of the pool. So Marcus is asking a question. What is the best way to deal with nervousness and anxiety before/during a presentation meeting? Oh,
I'll sprinkle it.
One of the things that people fear more than anything, or more than death itself, if according to Seinfeld, which is not a study, you know, scientifically, but there has been studies shown that it is one of the key things that we fear more than a lot of other things, publicly speaking. And that is how to handle the nervousness before prior walking up on a stage and doing a delivery. It can be just having in one of these sessions like we're having right now. I have three very simple, very basic, but they're so helpful advice for you, Marcus. Step number one, it's all about what we do prior to this. We need to go into a prime state of before we enter a situation, because otherwise the reptilian brain of us will just take control, meaning that we will just run around, we would do fidgeting and stroke things with our hands, we're probably gonna be swaying, everything that the brain is just telling you to get the hell out of Dodge. That is what your honest brain is telling you. But what you can do then is to calm that brain down, saying that, hey, you're in control, you got this. And the three things I want to give you is number one, prime yourself prior to, it's going to take like a half an hour prior to this, and set it as a routine. Number one, listen to music. I know it sounds like a cliche, like, oh, listen to powerful music. No, I'm going to take it to the next level. Listen to music that physically and mentally and psychologically places you in a time where you felt an emotion. that is connected to whatever you want to transmit to somebody else. I have found this recent love a couple of years back. Some people say it's a midlife crisis. I just say, hey, I discovered a passion late.
It's a midlife crisis.
It's a midlife crisis. I started riding motorcycles. I was so nervous because here in Scandinavia, it's super hard to get your driver's license whenever your motorcycle license, specifically here in Sweden. So every time I was out practicing, every time I was reading up on it, I was having some music that was connected, not when I was driving all the time, but I was having a specific song. That song I listened to the biggest day when it was D-Day. It was time to, like, driving day, getting my license. And I listened to that to my bike. I was listening to the way I was going for the exam. And then I passed. That song is now connected to me being proud, me feeling testosterone, me feeling really powerful. So whenever I'm nervous, I have that song, but I also have four other songs. So the first advice, create a 5-song playlist. That will help you, but make them connected to an emotion that you felt in life. Hashtag don't avoid choosing love songs or breakup songs, because love songs fine, but breakup songs, they're not gonna give you the right emotional state. Second thing, breathing pattern. We call it 7/60, proven by meditation, yoga, all that the science behind it shows that if you have an inhale pattern of 7 inhales and 7 exhales within 60 seconds, it will lower your heart rate. If you lower your heart rate, you're not gonna allow your brain to start producing and your body to produce cortisol, which is a stress-related hormone, which makes you nervous and creates anxiety. And the best thing of all, this, I have to, yeah, I just wait.
Go run, duck, dip, slip.
It's this one, yeah. You're probably going, oh, you're picking up the phone? No, but here's the beautiful thing. As a third and final thing, 2-3 minutes prior to walking up on a stage, I do it, David does it, whenever we're taking stages around the globe, we take a look at the phone for 2 to 3 minutes on either a clip or something that we love, a picture. And I take a look at this one. I don't know if you can see it right now, but this is my newborn puppy. It's a puppy. And it's my little Busse. This is now my little love of my life. Meaning that whenever I take a look at this, I start creating oxytocin. Oxytocin is the countermeasure for cortisol. The more oxytocin you have, the less cortisol you have. I.e., you now become more present, because that is one of the great features of oxytocin. So those would be my three, not fast ones, but really simple ones. Music, breathing pattern, looking at something on a phone or something that you love for 2 to 3 minutes.
Can I give my side?
Yeah, of course. Go ahead.
Yeah, so they're public speakers, all right? So maybe they don't remember as far back how did that feel. They remember people they coach, right? But I am a walking, talking example of presenter mastery. This, what we're doing now, would have been my biggest nightmare ever. Cortisol high, sweaty palms, heavy breathing, losing track of thought, the whole thing. Rather die than present. And I do this for a living. And this wasn't 5 years ago. This wasn't 10 years ago. This was, it's actually going to be 2 years in a week. Mm. We need to celebrate that.
Yep.
2 years ago, less than 2 years ago, I was a waiter. I was just lucky enough for David to stumble into that restaurant and serve him and his wife Maria some food. And he liked me, and he offered me coaching in exchange for some administration, and tricked me into this whole thing of having fun and not being nervous anymore. It's just, it's a skill like anything else. If I can do it, you can do it, they can do it, Marie can do it, Luca can do it.
The great thing with this is, guys, that there's so many of you still here. You're still, and I can just stretch this. Do the application, apply for this program. It will literally change the outcome of everything that you know. I know it sounds like a cliche, it's like we're just, hey, oh, this is, but it is the honest truth. There is a question here that came up, it's like, do we have any stories of people who joined the program and what are their success rates? We don't have one, we don't have three, we don't have five. We are up to like 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 people who are coming and going into this, or have come and gone into this program, who has excelled in everything. People who they were stuck at their work. They enjoyed this so much, so they just went, hey, you know what? I'm just going to start my own business. And they become successful doing that, earning thousands and thousands of revenue dollars in revenue each month or year. So yeah, we have so many several success stories into this program because it boils down to one simple thing, guys. Communication. When you're good at communicating, the sky is the limit. Oh, that was a cliche. Yeah. Using that. All right. So let's see. We have some more questions. We're jumping in. We keep on talking here. This one is for you, Stipe.
Tell me.
Can you pay as per session for the program, or how does the work?
You get the whole thing. The whole shebang, the community, the coaching, the analysis. Yeah. One doesn't work without the other. So if you don't pinpoint where you are, you'll be lost in a forest of information. Yep. If you don't practice in the coaching calls, not much is going to happen. Same, I can go back to the guitar reference. If I show you 100 videos of somebody playing a guitar, are you a guitar player? Not really. So it's one price, one investment, one move in your life that is going to help you. We do help you stretch it out through a couple of months. Yep. To ease the financial aspect of it. But one thing that very quickly pays itself off, and once it does, you use it in any skill, any role for the rest of your life, wherever you are, business or outside of the business. So yep. Sounds like a good deal.
All right, let's see what other good questions we have. Can you share a story of how one of the applicants transformed their life with the program?
Oh, which one do you want?
Yeah, which one do we want to go
Big
with?
Big one.
I like this one. There was there was a guy who joined in, and he was, like I mentioned, he was doing like regular stuff on a high level, like C-level leadership position, and he was so just utterly bored with the way that PowerPoints were created. And he talked a lot about the data and how that was going to be transferred and blah blah, and he was just like, he came into the program and was like, guys, I need to change something up, I need to spice things up, I need to do something with this. So he embarked on the program. He were there for the first 3 months, joined every single call, did everything that he needed to do. After that, all of a sudden, his points in, like, the appreciation from the coworkers started to increase. From there, he just went and say, hey, you know what? I can do this. So he started making his data sing and dance. So even if he just showed the graph where it was numbers or statistics, he created those stories connected to it, made him just go from a high level to even a higher level, where he realized somewhere down the line that I'm just going to quit my job. So he now started a successful business helping other people with their communication and making them grow in their businesses, specifically startups. So he's now, like I said, making thousands of dollars in revenue each month just of good communication, and it all came from that little embryo of saying, hey, I got a bad PowerPoint, how can I change the outcome of this?
Yeah, and how many people hated their job? Felt stuck.
True.
And their ability or inability to present themselves kept them at the very same spot. It got dull, it got boring, there was no promotions. We've seen people getting better roles.
Yep.
We've seen people landing a better job. We've seen people performing better at job interviews. We've seen people within the community starting the business on their own. We've seen people attracting investors quicker with story, because if you can make yourself 20 times more memorable for an investor or in a meeting, yeah, you're the only one they'll remember. So yep, you're the only one you're going to get that email. So we've seen a lot of it, a lot of success stories, and planning on adding some more.
I have, there's another question I will jump into, and then we'll start looking into seeing if David is on his way back soon, so he will share that final little thing that majority of you are waiting for. Sarah is asking, what is your opinion on the common approach, our top 10 tips on good for boosting dopamine? I would say this. When you use, there's two approaches to this. When you overwhelm people with saying, okay, here's so many top tip advices on something, you kind of lose a little bit of the interest of that, because it gets too overwhelming for an individual. So they might zoom out Instead, you can be strategically smart and say, you know, I have three top tips of the today and I'm going to give you, and there is one of those that will make the biggest difference. That, yeah, exactly. They were like, what is it? What is it? Please, are you going to tell us? No, this was just an example. So I would say using too many can overwhelm an individual, but if you're strategic and you're very smart, maybe using three and then selecting one of those. If you want to keep a good one, it's called, it's also called, it's from the ancient Greek, it's called hexakolon. And the hexakolon is when you use the power of six. That is when you get like, you start having a sensation or an emotion created in somebody else. So if you want to create an emotion, then you use the power of six. If you really want to drive the anticipation, then yeah, I would recommend with using three and just lift one of those up and saying, yeah, but that one, this one I will give you, this is better than all of the other three advices. That is really the top tip of the day. All right, good. Now it is time. It is time to, well, he started it and he's going to finish it. But you are all expecting something from someone that you have listened to for roughly an hour. So I'm going to welcome back Mr. David J.P. Phillips to the stage!
Hey! Hey, boys. Hey, boys.
This, are you ready to share with them? You ready? Yeah.
This one fun. Is worth the wait.
Yeah, this
that
was
is
fun.
For
yeah.
sure.
Right. It was fun. Okay. Enjoy.
Can I see? I'm seeing clearly here. All right. So here we go. So when I... This was like a realization, a revelation when I saw it and I realized that this was the case. So when I studied the 5,000 public speakers, again, took me around 7 years. I also had help with my team because that's too many to do yourself. I found these 110 skills, right? But I got bored now and then, which isn't odd because literally that is a long time to do that single thing, one focus, one project. So I got bored and my brain was going like, is there anything else I can focus on just without just looking at skills? So I asked myself this question. Wonder what the primary reason is that people enjoy presentations. Like, what is the reason? Okay, it's a fair question to ask, right? So if I were to write a book on this particular subject, I did actually write a book on another subject which came out pretty recently. I'm just going to show that before I get into the answer. This one's called, this is not about sex. This is the Swedish word for sex. That means six in Swedish. So six substances that change your life. So it's about how you can increase dopamine and oxytocin and serotonin in yourself on command. Just what I talked about before, the presenter part of it. This one became so popular. It's been a bestseller for the last 8 months since it came out, and it's been sold to 28 countries, and it's coming out in everything from Japanese to Chinese to English to, well, practically any language out there. So the English one is coming out on the 1st of February. Keep a lookout for it. It's going to be called High on Life in English. All right, anyhow, here we go. If I'd write a book about this, the essence would obviously be What actually makes presentations desirable, powerful? And the shocking result is this. It is not as much as what you say as the amount of variations, right? Okay, so the drum roll on this is this. The more variations you have in the same period of time will equal a better objective experience. That's it. So you can literally have one presenter who's got this amazing subject but has no variations or very little variations. They may score a 2 out of 5. And then you have this one presenter who talks about gibberish or nothing really, but they have loads of variation. They will score a 4. That is scary. But I think you've seen this as well. I think you've seen people around you who are able to pitch ideas, but somebody else in the room actually had a better idea, but nobody listened to that. All right, so here we go. Variation is the key. So I want to ask you this now. Which variations have I used? Right? I want you to write in the chat. Which variations have I used since we began? Which variations during this call have I used? I'll give you just an example before you start writing. PowerPoint and storytelling, two different things. That's a variation. So variation, not in delivery skills, not speed and pitch, but in content. So come on. Stories we have there, we have flip chart, we have flip books, videos, come on, very good, keep on. Asking questions, PowerPoint, storytelling, flip chart, setting, Janko, good one. All right, so those are all skills from Dr. Doreen. Repetition is actually content, so that would be correct. And designs, we change people, we use gestures. Keep on going, all right, so I think you found about 12, the answer is 40. I used 40 variations during this 1 hour, 40. So when we do trainings we did some recently for Google and Microsoft, where we did entire day trainings on public speaking. 8 hours on Zoom, 8 hours. And when we're at the end, they go, I cannot believe that was 8 hours, because it just flew away. Digital and physical, there's no difference. So there we go. You had a bunch of them. Now I'm going to show you all of them. Are you ready? Because these are, how many variations are there? 136, and they look like this. So if you, I don't know if this looks good at your end, but take a screenshot of it if you want this, because this is your primary way of getting this. If you want it in a more detailed version, you have the resource package, which you can get to this training. Pop it up, they didn't have time, Marcus. A bit more, there we go. Take your mobile phone or take a screenshot of that so you have it. But if you want the entire thing, and if you want description for every single one of the 136, there's a very, very inexpensive resource package which you can buy to this session. And it's this, right? It's massive. It's massive. It took about 2-3 months to write. It's half a book. That's the key, my friend. So that's the last and final thing I wanted to leave you with. It is more about the amount of variations in your presentation than the content itself, which is scary. But if you got good content and variation, boom, you are in for a win. That was all from me in Sweden. I'm going to Stockholm now, which is our capital, to see the book launch of a friend of mine by the name Matilda. So that's the end of my day. It's going to be nice. If you haven't booked the call yet and you want to take this opportunity, just go in and book your spot. Besides that, see me on social media, on Instagram or on LinkedIn, where I'm active, and I hope that you have received some good tips. From the bottom of my heart, this is the most important skill in your life. So whether you learn it from me or not, please, for God's sake, learn it. Okay? Become brilliant at this, wherever you go. Take care. Goodbye. Ciao, ciao.
And there we go. That was the end of that webinar. I hope you enjoyed it. I know I enjoyed doing it, and it took me years and years to assemble the skills in it to give it to you. So I hope that was well worth it. And Lucas, where can they find even more info?
Yes, well, if you like what you heard and want to learn more about the Presenter Mastery program, you can go to presentermastery.com/apply. There you'll find the full curriculum, what we do inside of Presenter Mastery. You'll find an option to book a call with our team and discuss even further. So just go on to that, presentermastery.com/apply, and we look forward to speaking to you.
Great, man.
Yeah. Thank you. See you next week.